Come on, church. Lift up your voice.
There is no power in hell, nor any who can stand against the power and the presence of the great.
Come on. Oh, the great I am.
The great I am.
Lift up your praise in this place.
The great I am, who is worthy, none beside thee, God Almighty, the great I am. Hallelujah, Lord. Holy is your name. You are worthy, O God. You are the great I am. We glorify your name. Holy, holy, holy. Oh, blessed be your name. Jesus.
There is no other name.
There is no power in hell, nor any who can stand before the presence and the presence of the great I am.
Oh, the great I am.
Great I am. Great I am.
Great I am.
Great I am.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
To come. Oh, there is no one beside you, Lord.
The great I am.
Oh, hallelujah, Lord. There is none beside you, Lord. There is none beside you, Lord. No one, Lord God, compares to you. Oh, in this place, Lord. Lord, we are your children. We are. Lord, and nothing and no one compares to you. So, Lord, just as we shout out with a shout of praise, with a shout of triumph, as we lift our voice in song and celebration, Lord, it's not because of who we are and what we have done, but, Lord, it is all because of who you are and what you have done and what you have promised you will do. What you will do, Lord God. So today, Lord, we stand amazed. In the presence, we stand amazed in the presence of our God and King. We stand amazed that you have chosen us, that you have called us by name. Lord, we stand amazed that you desire time with us. And so, Father, as we just take time with you, Lord, we are so grateful for the sweetness of your presence. We're so grateful that we can take this time. Lord, you're good. Father, we pray this morning for those that are unable to be with us this morning for whatever reason. Lord, that you'd be with them, watch over them. Lord, we lift up Linda Holland's dad's side here this morning. Lord, as he's in Health South recovering, Lord, we just pray that your hand would be upon him. Lord, he desires to be here. He wants to be here, but Lord, the whole body is just failing right now. So Lord, we just pray that you would touch him. Lord, touch him. Lord, as we've prayed for Eileen this morning, Lord, just bring her through this surgery, Lord God. We know that you're there. You're faithful. Lord, we're trusting in you. Lord, for you are great. You're greater than all the physical ailments that could ever come upon us because you created us. You know us. Lord, for others this morning, just touch them. Just minister to them. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to come and worship and to give you all of our praise and all of our glory. We thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Isn't the presence of Jesus wonderful? Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God is so good. He is so good. Amen. You may be seated. Glory to his name. Amen. Well, back in September of 1934, Bellwood Assembly of God was founded by the late Reverend Nora Verbonitz. And the church's earliest origin was in the Bellwood Grange Hall. I know there are several members of our church this morning that are not here because they are actually out at the Grange Fair in Center Hall, but this was a different Grange. But it was founded at the Grange Hall, and O.L. Weaver, the O.L. Weaver building on Main Street. Miss Verbonitz resigned her pastorship for a time, went on the evangelistic field. Several years later, Miss Verbonitz was asked to return. And in 1946, the church purchased ground at North 2nd and Tuckahoe Streets, where a basement was built and dedicated July 7th, 1947. So you could say the Assembly of God Church in Bellwood had its beginnings underground. Under the leadership of Pastor Gregory Fisher, the church building was completed in 1961, opened for worship in June of 1962, and dedicated June 26, 1963. Mrs. Nora Verbonitz went to be with the Lord in 1992. The same year, ground was broken here for new life. In the late 1980s, I'm not going to share all this because Pastor Tim is going to share much of this, I'm sure. Late 1980s, Bellwood Assembly of God was bequeathed this 6 acres property here on Ritz Road by Mr. and Mrs. Leo Wachter. However, with a dwindling congregation, funds were not available for building on the site. With years of ups and downs behind them, two congregations were ready for change. The idea of a merger was presented. River of Life had the money to build, but not land on which to do so. They also had a pastor, who you're going to hear from in just a couple of moments. Bellwood is here for New Life Assembly of God. And I'm going to leave it at that. And I want you to turn your attention to the video screen. And I'm going to introduce Pastor Tim. And as soon as the video is over, Tim, come on up and have your leisure. But Pastor Tim Halbfoerster was that founding pastor. Back when it was River of Life, the two churches came together, had a wonderful marriage ceremony. And it's so wonderful to have him back with us 25 years later to celebrate what God has done and to look forward to what God is going to
the Lord, he is holy and just, by his power we trust in his love. Great is is the Lord. Holy and just, by his power we trust in his love. Great is the Lord, he is faithful and true, by his mercy he is love. Great is the Lord and worthy of glory. Great is the Lord and worthy of praise. Great is the Lord, now lift up your voice, now lift up your voice.
Wow, that was terrific. Man, I got blessed just watching that. Isn't God good? Well, my name is Pastor Tim Halbfoerster, and it's so good to be back with you today. Just honored to be here. Thank you, Pastor Wayne, for inviting us. Beautiful accommodations last night. We got in last evening. Got a good night of sleep, so thankful to be with you here today. I thought for just a couple of minutes I'd give you a little brief Halbfoerster update and then get into preaching the Word of God. We are now married for 36 years. Thank the Lord for that. We have three daughters that are now all married, thank God. They're all out of the house, praise the Lord. Love them very much, but also excited that they're out of the house. And we're just enjoying being empty nesters. Our oldest daughter, Heather, is an ordained pastor with the Assemblies of God. And she's also a certified licensed marriage and family therapist. Her and her husband live in the Greensburg area, and they've just given birth last year to a beautiful little son. His name is AJ, as we call him. And we just love to FaceTime him and love to spend time with him. We saw him the other day. He calls my wife Nana, and he calls me Pop. And so we just enjoy him so much. Also, my middle daughter, Ashley, she is married to her husband Joe, and they live in the Enola area where we're pastoring. They have three children. Our oldest granddaughter is 9 years old. She's getting ready to go back to school tomorrow. Her name is Kylie. Her middle child is named Lucas. Lucas is starting kindergarten tomorrow, and we have to pray for those teachers at the school. He's quite a handful, and he is 5 years old, soon be six. And then his sister, Mackenzie, is just turning five on September 1st, and so we're so thankful for all the grandkids. That's all of them four. And then our youngest daughter, Amber, got married in the fall of this past year, and she decided to go down to the Outer Banks. She wanted a beach wedding. And I said, now, Amber, remember that that's the end of season. And sure enough, a hurricane blew through there during her wedding. And so we had to adjust, and we ended up doing the wedding in a house that my mom had rented. Had a beautiful wedding, and she got married, and her husband, Wesley, live in the D.C. area. He actually works for Congress and just walks up the street to the Capitol building. And she's a school teacher there in the Virginia area right across the river. And just so thankful for our family. Marie and I have been pastors now for 30 years. This was our second pastorate, and so all of you that endured that pastorate need to have a good pat on the back, because we were young and inexperienced, and thank you for loving us and putting up with us. All these years later, we are now in Enola, pastoring River of God Church. So we've been there for almost 21 years, and we have two campuses, one in the inner city of Harrisburg. It's a bilingual church. Today they'll be ministering in English and in Spanish, and God is touching a lot of folks there. It's in a very difficult area of Harrisburg. It's not unusual to have prostitutes and drug dealers coming in there, giving their lives to Jesus Christ, and God's just touching lives there in the city of Harrisburg. We pastor the church in Enola, and I've been there all these years, and I've just been enjoying so much the work of the kingdom of God. Some years ago, back in 2002, I had opportunity to help start a ministry for the Pendel District of the Assemblies of God entitled Bridge Builders. And so now, for the last bunch of years here, around to churches that are in conflict and doing mediation work for them and helping do some coaching and also do some training. Actually, next weekend, I'll be up in the Erie area preaching for a pastor and doing some training on conflict resolution. And sometimes you can't resolve a conflict. Sometimes you just manage it. So sometimes it's more conflict management. But just enjoying working for the Lord all these years. So thankful for the years that we had here in the Altoona, Bellwood area. I'm going to ask you to stand this morning for the word of the Lord. As I was preparing for this day, looking so forward to celebrating 25 years of breaking ground here on this property, the Lord just put on my heart the importance of the altar. I began to think about all the times that God met me and met this church at an altar. And I want to talk to you today about the power of the altar. In Genesis chapter 8 and verse 20, in the NIV version, it says, "Then Noah built an altar to the Lord. And take all the clean animals and clean birds, he sacrificed burnt offerings on it." Hebrews 13:10, I love this verse. The Bible tells us there, we have an altar from which those who minister at the tabernacle have no right to eat. And then over in Hebrews 4 and 16, very familiar verse, "Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with confidence," or with boldness, "so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need." With me, Father, thank you so much that today we celebrate all these awesome years of you touching lives here in this region. God, I thank you that you've been moving and working in this church, even in this present hour. Thank you, God, for the way you're touching lives here, the way you're touching lives across this region, especially among the young generation. God, thank you for Pastor Micah and his work. Thank you for Pastor Wayne and his work here as well. God, we just pray continued blessings on this. Choose this church as a powerful lighthouse in this region. Father, I just ask now that you'll just hide your servant and everyone in this room in the shadow of the cross. Move and work through the time of the ministry of your word. And God, I ask at the end of this message that people will be flooded around this altar meeting with you. And I know, God, if they'll come to meet with you, you will meet with them. We thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Praise God, you made it. I'm going to show you a little picture here of a couple from a few years back. And you can take a look at that. Those were some pretty woolly people back in the day. Some wild folks. I grew up in an unchurched home, even though I was sent to church to get confirmed. And I didn't really know much about an altar. The only time in that church we ever went to the altar was to take communion. And we would do that, you know, once a month. And that was the only time we ever went to the altar. And so I really didn't know the Lord. I didn't know much about God. I just had a few basic Bible teachings. And I ended up dating this young lady at the age of 17. And from 17 to 19, I helped her to fall away from God. I really helped her to backslide. I took her places and we did things that we should have never have done. And we were living very ungodly lives. During those days, I was selling drugs in the Lehigh Valley area. I was dealing and using a lot. I almost killed Marie. That's who that is up there, in case you don't know. My present and only wife. Amen. Thankful for her. But I remember back in the day, I just about killed her with a drug overdose and just was living a crazy life. And so one night, I ended up crashing my brand new Firebird Formula, drunken on drugs, into a police car. I want to recommend to you not to hit a police car. They don't like it very much. The policeman got on the radio and he calls his buddies. And before you know it, because it was a local township cop, they ended up having the sheriff there. And then there also was the state police there. And it was the state police who arrested me. And I remember sitting in the back of that police cruiser. I was handcuffed and still messed up from the drugs and the alcohol, but I was starting to come to. And I remember talking to the policemen, and if one of them would have been born again, I probably would have got saved that night right in the back of that car. Something had happened to my girlfriend, Marie. A few weeks earlier, she had made a decision. She was going to begin to serve the God of her youth. And she gave her life back to Jesus Christ on a Wednesday night. And on that Wednesday night, as she rededicated her life to Christ, God filled her with the power of the Holy Spirit all at the same time. And she pointed her little finger at me and she said, "I'm going to live for Jesus, whether you like it or not." I didn't like it very much and I broke. And this accident happened because I was out running around with other girls and doing other stuff. And I'll tell you, God arrested me that night. And it was just a day later, I ended up... didn't have to go to jail. My dad knew the judge, and a phone call in the middle of the night kept me out of jail. But I ended up going to church that Sunday night. I got high one last time and playing baseball with a team that we literally were called the Demons. That was the name of our softball team. We play every afternoon for kegs of beer. Whoever won didn't have to pray for the beer. Whoever, of course, lost had to pay for it. And I remember playing softball that last time, getting high one more time. And I went to church that Sunday night. And my pastor preached away, gave the word, gave the altar call. I was sitting all the way back in the second last pew. And I didn't want to come to the front of the church. Was still not ready yet to come to the front of the church and make a big deal in front of people. I felt God's power on me. And I knelt down in the second last pew. As I knelt down in the second last pew, I came undone. All of a sudden, the pride and all the hurt from abuse that I had gone through and all those years of drug addiction and alcohol abuse, all that came to an end in the second last pew. My pastor came right back to me. He had been praying for me. He'd been asking God to get a hold of my life. He came back to me and looked at me, and he pointed his finger at me, Christ. And so I talk to you about the altar today, because the altar is something each of us need in our own individual walk with God. The church needs altar experiences. We need altar experiences in our own individual lives. And so for a moment, allow me to just define the altar for you. In the Old Testament, the very first place you'll find the altar, Genesis 8:20, you'll find that that word for altar is used tabernacle. That they had an altar built out of acacia wood that was overlaid with bronze, and it was called the brazen altar. It was a place of judgment where sacrifices were killed and offered to God, burned up to God. It's a type of the cross. If you move into the tabernacle, you'll find another altar was there, the golden altar of incense. That also was made of acacia wood, which speaks and symbolizes the humanity of Christ. But the gold that made that acacia wood was speaking of the deity of Jesus Christ, that he is the Son of God. But every day, incense would burn off of that altar up to God, and that represents the prayers and the praises and the worship of God's people. So if you look at the Word of God, you'll find throughout the Word of God these moments in the history of the people of God where powerful altar experiences changed lives, gave direction, and also provided provision. So the big idea of this message today is powerful altar experiences can provide transformation, provision, and direction. Let me give that to you one more time. Powerful altar experiences can provide transformation, provision, and direction. I'm going to share two things with you today, two main. I want to talk to you about remembering altars. It's a good thing to remember altar experiences. And then secondly, today I'm going to share with you about the importance of rebuilding altars. Rebuilding altars. First of all, remembering altars. As we remember the very first altar in the Bible, I've referenced it already, in Genesis 8 and verse 20. The very first thing that Noah did when he came out of the ark, and of course all the animals came, his family came out of the ark, the very first thing he did was to build an altar to God. I believe that's significant. The world had been destroyed by the flood. And the very first thing this man of God does, who preserved the human race, was to build an altar to God. So you cannot say today that altars are not important. We cannot say today that an altar experience that maybe some people need. Thank God that altar experiences are something each and every one of us need on a regular basis in our lives. And Noah knew that. I don't know if you've had opportunity yet to go down to Kentucky to check out Noah's Ark down there. It is amazing. We took a motorcycle ride down there with our local hog chapter out of the dealership in Harrisburg. And we were there with people that are unchurched and a place where maybe you wouldn't think a pastor should be. And you definitely have to look away sometimes. And there's a whole lot of stuff that goes on there. But we're there to serve them. We're there to minister to them. And we've had some amazing encounters with the Lord. As a matter of fact, yesterday, we were doing a boot shine at the Appalachian Harley dealership right there in Mechanicsburg. And this man comes up to me. His name is Ed. Someone had given him a Bible and said, I challenge you to read this Bible. And so Ed is Bible through. He's now in the book of Kings. And he told me that he's really been enjoying it, and he says that he needed to get his bike blessed. A bike blessing really isn't about the machine, it's about the person who rides it. And so right there, a couple of us Black Sheep brothers joined hands with him, and we prayed right around his bike. And man, we're praying, God, just reveal yourself to him. We're praying, God, just show up in his life. Protect him on the bike, of course, and let creation be revealed. As creation reveals who you are, God, let him just... And when we're done, and that's an altar right there at that motorcycle. When we're done, he just gave me a big old hug, man. He was trembling. The Holy Spirit was on him. He was just touched. It was awesome. So I want to tell you that an altar isn't necessarily an altar in a church, but certainly can be. An altar is any place where you meet God, a place where you get together with the Lord, and no one knew the importance of that altar. I want to talk to you about another altar in Hebrews 13:10. The Bible tells you have an altar from which those who minister at the tabernacle have no right to eat. Really what that's talking about is there's an altar that you and I have today as New Testament believers, and that altar is Jesus. Jesus has become that brazen altar when he died on the cross. Jesus has fulfilled everything of the Old Testament. He is our altar. He's the one we go to. So when you really think of it, an altar experience is just a moment with Jesus. Look at somebody near you and tell them, you need a moment with Jesus. Tell them that today. We all need these moments with Jesus Christ. So I want to talk to you about remembering the altar. I want to talk about some of the new life altars that I was remembering as I prepared for this day with you of celebration. I remember it was back in 1986. I was down south in Louisiana at a pastor's conference. And while during an altar time, God spoke to my heart and he told me to go to Altoona to start a church. I remember it like yesterday. But I remember also at the time, Brother Jim Grove, who was the presbyter of this section, was really ill during that time. He actually had some heart issues and was unable to connect with me. And so for a few months, I had it on the back burner. But early in the year of 1987, I gave a call to Brother Jim, who was feeling better at that time, and through one conversation, it was all worked out. We were going to come to this area of Altoona, and we were going to begin to start a church for the glory of God. We went around to different churches, and we preached and spent some time raising some funds, and churches of this section got behind us, gave us thousands and thousands of dollars to start the church. Actually, the Assemblies of God also helped us during those early days of pastoring, to buy a piece of land that I'll talk to you about in just a moment. But go with us. It was such an awesome time. But our coming to Altoona was all because of an altar experience with the Lord Jesus Christ and him personally directing us to be here. For 4 years, we pastored River of Life Assembly of God in the Wynwood and Juniata section of Altoona. I remember when we were ready to start and we needed a building, I said, God, we can't afford much to rent, and you got to help us. We got about $100 a month that we could rent for a building. I remember when we contacted the Union Hall back on Wapsonic Avenue there, back by the Penn State Altoona campus, and they were willing to rent it to us for $100 a month. And I still remember back to the very first service there. It was Easter Sunday of 1987, and I remember a man gave his life to Jesus Christ, and we didn't have an altar because this was a Union Hall. As a matter of fact, it was a dangerous place for church people to go. If you hit the wrong on the soda machine, you might get beer out of the soda machine. It was a little bit problematic when you have kids in the church. But anyhow, it was not unusual to have to clear out a whole afternoon of beer smell and a cigarette smell and all that went on in that Union Hall in order to have church in that evening there. But it was such an awesome experience because I was praying, God, just show us that we're supposed to be here by saving someone at the end of the service. And at the end of that folding chair, a young man gave his life to the Lord Jesus Christ. In the early days of our pastoring here, it was lean. During those times of early church planning in the Assemblies of God, they would parachute you in. They kind of set you up and help you out for a little bit, but it was really lean as far as finances would go. And I remember things got so bad one time financially for us that my daughter, Ashley, our middle daughter, had surgery on her eye. And I remember how it was just to really know what to do because we had no money to buy eye medicine for her. We were totally broke. It was another week and a half till we got paid. And I remember sitting in my home office and I looked up to God and I said, God, you got to provide this money. I need to get her this medicine. I need to get it for her today. I also need some gas in the car too. It was the lowest point financially we've ever been in our lives. I remember sitting in that office, leaning on my chair, an older time. I looked up at a deer head that I had mounted. And on the bottom of that deer head were some legs, and on that a rifle. And God said to me, there's your provision. So I went down the street a few blocks to a gun dealer and sold that gun and got my daughter medicine for her eyes, put gas in the tank, and thanked the Lord for his provision. I want to tell you, friends, when you call on God at a time of altar, he'll provide for your needs. Some of you may be hurting here today. Some of you may be at a critical moment in your life. I want to assure you today, after all these years of seeing God move in my own life and in the lives of others, he hasn't forgotten you. And he'll meet you at an altar if you'll meet with him. As we remember these incredible altar experiences, we were looking to buy some property. And I'm going to show you the next slide here. We were looking to buy some property. And during an altar time, during a prayer time with God, God just put on my heart, ad in the newspaper to find some property. Now, how many of you know that's a very unusual way to find property for a church? But we couldn't find any ground. Nothing was available. We had come to an end of what we were trying to look for, and nothing was working out. And so I put that ad right there in the Altoona Mirror, and someone responded to it on the last day that it ran. And so he tells me, he said, I think I have the property that you're looking for. And so we were back to that again. And yet I began to hear of the story of the Bellwood Assembly of God, how the church had begun to dwindle some in number, and how the pastor had left, and this beautiful piece of property was here. And so in conversations with our presbyter, Jim Grove, and with his precious wife, Jane, we began to pray and began to talk about the possibility of a merger with Bellwood Assembly of God. And I want to show you the next slide here. Just so thankful that was the ground there in Wynwood that we bought. That was quite a story. We had some trees that were on that property. It was a really messy lot. We tore down the trees, upset the neighborhood. They complained, and it was on the front page of a Sunday morning Altoona Mirror. That's not really where you want to be when it's stuff like that. But anyway, quite a story. You can go to the next slide if you would, please. So we decide, after both congregations had been meeting God and talking to God about this, we just are going to begin to start this merging of the two churches together. This is the actual sign that we put out on the church in Juniata where we were meeting. We were meeting right there on 4th Street and right in a place that was next to a pizza place. One time they played a trick on me there. They got all these pizzas like for the whole church, and they wanted to give me the bill for it, you know. But of course, it was all paid for, but they didn't tell me that, and it was quite a deal. I mean, can you imagine trying to have church when people are hungry and all you smell is pizza coming through the over the area of the roof there in the ceiling into the building? But we had some experiences. We were right next to a couple bars there, and it wasn't unusual for drunk guys to just barge in. And I remember one guy saying one day, hey, I was a gunner in the Second World War, and he disrupted the whole service. I said, sit down. You can be a part of the army of God if you like, and you know. And we've had some experiences there. It was awesome. It was fun. But I remember putting that sign out of the church doors of the River of Life Church, and we began to come together, and all of a sudden momentum was there, and excitement was there, and we began to just plan for a wedding ceremony. I want to show you the next picture here. There was our wedding invitation. We decided, it was actually Brother Grove's idea to do the wedding, and he had heard about this, and it was such a great idea. Two congregations say, I do. And so we actually did a wedding ceremony, and you can see that newspaper art there. We got some good press. We actually are on Cornerstone TV with that whole deal as well. And it was just an awesome experience for us as a congregation. And we married the two churches together. Brother Grove was helping to conduct that as well as myself. And what an awesome thing. So then, after the wedding, what do you do after a wedding? You have a reception. You celebrate. So we went back to the River of Life building that we had still had rented. Went back there, and that's where the reception. And so now the deacons on both sides of the church, you know, now become one. They decided it would be fun to take cake, the wedding cake, and put in each other's faces. So that's how we broke the ice. That's how we became one. We smeared cake into each other's faces. Of course, my wife smeared it in my face because she always likes to do that. Did that at our wedding, did that at our 25th anniversary. But what an exciting journey it was. And so it wasn't too long after that that we were praying to believe God to build this first church building over here, and we were coming to this property. So I'll show you the next slide here, and that's why we're here today, celebrating 25 years. It was a cold day. You can see I have a big old overcoat on. The other guys do, and I remember breaking ground here. It was an awesome experience. We built that first phase facility here and moved into that church. And I remember soon after we moved in, we were having regular services now in the new building. And man, God was moving and God was blessing and touching lives. But it wasn't all easy. Because before we could even get into the building, you can show the next slide if you would. Before we could all get into the next building and just enjoy that facility, we went through some difficulties, man. There were some problems with a permit that had been pulled. Someone had gotten a permit for us, and we didn't know that the permit should have never been given to build. And the permit was all about the DER planning module that had to be done. And as soon as we hooked up the sewer to the Pepsi-Cola sewer, man, all of a sudden the township folks came out, and they put a big old red tag on the building. The building is about half built. People are committed to working on the building throughout the summer of that year and in the fall of that year. And all of a sudden now, from the 4th of July weekend until way into October, no construction on the building right over here. And it was tough. And I remember talking to God about this. I was upset with the township. And I remember, man, I had the whole church riled up, man. This was an injustice. And we were going to take the whole church to the township meeting. We were going to tell them what we thought. And at an altar experience, the Holy Spirit said to me, just take the deacon board and calm down. I was young and passionate in those days. And so I'm just taking the deacon board, and God began to work. And soon after that, I went to the Pendel Conference Center. There was a retreat there for pastors. Back then, that was called Ministers Institute, and now it's called Ministers Enrichment. But we went to that meeting, and there was a guy that God said, this is the man you need to talk to. He was a powerful lobbyist in Harrisburg. And so I met with him, talked with him, and in one day in Harrisburg, everything got worked out. We were back to building the church, and soon after that, we moved into the church. But all of that because of powerful altar experiences with God. As I look at the people of that picture, as I look at all the pictures in the videos, in the video we saw today, as I look out at you today, friends, powerful altar experiences can provide transformation, can provide provision, and can provide direction. I want to talk to you lastly here about rebuilding the altar. We need to rebuild our altar. In 1 Kings 18:30, Elijah said to all the people, come near to me. So all the people came near to him, and he repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down. Elijah was up on top of Mount Carmel. If you ever get to Israel, you'll have to go to Mount Carmel. Mount Carmel overlooks where the Battle of Armageddon is going to happen, the Valley of Megiddo. As there a few years ago, I saw the statue they have there of Elijah with his sword in his hand, the very sword with which he killed the prophets of Baal. 450 prophets of Baal and 400 prophets of Asherah were there, and they had a showdown on top of Mount Carmel. Elijah was telling them, who are you going to choose to serve? Why do you keep faltering? Why do you keep going back between two opinions? In other words, are you going to serve God of Israel, or are you going to serve the false gods of Ahab and Jezebel? And so on that very mountain, there was a tremendous showdown. The story is well documented. The story has been well preached over the years. 1 Kings chapter 18. It's interesting that the prophets of Baal did everything they could to try to call fire down on the sacrifice in order to make it clear to Israel that their God was real. They did things like dancing and just to make God show off a little bit. He even put water on the sacrifice, and he put water in a trench all the way around the altar, and he cried out a simple prayer to God, and the fire of God fell from heaven and consumed the sacrifice and completely evaporated all the water around the sacrifice, around the altar. Our God answers when we cry out to him because he's real and he's alive. Look at somebody near you and tell them our God's alive. So the question to you, this is a challenge to you. What's your altar look like? Do you have a personal altar? Are you talking to God? Are you calling on God on a regular basis? It's good to pray, and I was so blessed to see people coming up during worship and praying around this altar. That's awesome. But we also need to have a personal altar outside of church. Come on. We need to have those times where it's just you and Jesus. Those times where you just receive from God and you just are ministered to by Him and you in turn minister to Him and worship. And so we need our own personal altar. We also need to rebuild the home altar. Coming back to this Altoona area is so wonderful for us because of all the memories we have. As I look to the house that we bought for $13,000 in Juniata, man, I wish you could buy a house for $13,000 these days. But I remember in the upstairs house, there was bedrooms for our daughters, and I can still see Marie and I going into the bedrooms of our daughters at night, right before they're ready to go to sleep. You know, they're all bathed and in their jammies, and I can still see us going in there and reading the Bible to them, little kids' Bibles, and praying with them. Sometimes we'd act out the stories. Sometimes they'd act out the stories. But I remember those early days, and I'm thankful for those moments of altar together. But I would encourage you as a family to pray together. Don't underestimate the power of prayer with your spouse. Don't underestimate the power of prayer with your family. You say, Pastor, I'm single, I'm alone. Friend, there may be some folks that you'll be able to partner with and encourage in a time of family prayer. Who knows? Be open and allow the Lord to move and work through you. And then we need to rebuild the school altar. There was a day in the United States where there was a school altar, where there was Bible reading and prayer. Now, I went still a school altar. There's still Bible reading in school. As long as there are born-again Christians in these schools, there's going to be Bible reading, there's going to be prayer. It may be a little discreet, it may be a little quiet, but I can tell you my daughter Amber, who teaches fourth grade in Virginia, she prays a lot in school. I can tell you that in the public school she teaches, and she has some challenging kids. And as long as there's tests, as it's been said, there'll always be prayer in school. But I want to urge you, as the school year starts, you may want to just slip to your local school and just maybe walk around that school campus. Maybe you have to do it outside. Maybe you can get inside. I don't know. But just pray over that school. Ask God to move and work in the lives of the students there. You've got an incredible thing happening here in the Youth Network that Pastor Micah is leading. It's awesome. And so we need to pray that God will use these young people this school year. A few years back, we were praying in the school in Enola. We were literally laying hands on lockers and praying over that whole school. We were allowed to go in there in the evenings. And it wasn't too long after that that a young man died a tragic death. And all of a sudden, I had the whole senior class in front of me on a holiday day when his funeral was. And I was able to give them the gospel of Jesus Christ. Don't underestimate the power of altars in school, prayer times in school. Thank God for Bible club, other things like that. And then lastly, I want to speak to you about rebuilding the church altar. In Revelation 2 and verse 4, our worship team can come back. The Bible tells us, nevertheless, I have this against you, that you have left your first love. Notice it doesn't say that you lost your first love. You can't lose your first love for God, but you can leave it. Loving God isn't just something, you know, that you just lose, but it's something that you leave. Often something happens in our life where we begin to move back from the altar. Maybe we get offended. Maybe we get disappointed. Maybe something's happened to us. Maybe a prayer didn't get answered the way we thought it should. Maybe we're just off track at that time in our life. Maybe we've gone a direction that God never intended for us to go. And so we back off of the altar. And I want to encourage you to see what it says here in Revelation. He says, remember, therefore, from which you have fallen, and repent and do the first works. If your altar needs to be rebuilt, rebuild it with repentance. Tell God you're sorry that you haven't been meeting with Him. Let the Lord know that you miss Him. And you want to be back in relationship with Him. You want that fire and that anointing and blessing on that you had when you first began to walk with Him. You want to hear His voice again. Come to Him in repentance. Come to Him in faith. And then it goes on to say, and do the first works, or else I'll come to you quickly and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. Last story. I remember Saturday night prayers here at New Life. We were meeting in the Saturday evenings, and for whatever reason, I happened to be the only one at a prayer meeting. The church didn't know at that time that I had been contacted to start another church. A group of people were meeting the Bellefonte area, and they wanted me to become their first pastor. The church didn't know. And so there I was, all alone in that big sanctuary. It's a lot bigger when you're alone. I said, God, you've done all these things all these years here. What do you want of us? And I felt in that prayer time, that altar time, just me and God. And maybe that's the way he exactly wanted, just me and him. That he took the burden of pastoring this church off of me. So I can literally say that God gave me the burden to pastor here, and he removed the burden to pastor here, all in an altar experience. But I'm thankful that altar experiences for the church don't begin or start or end with me. I'm so thankful God uses pastors over the years to bring people to a place where they can meet with God. Friend, if there's one thing I want to challenge you to be, is be people of the altar. If we want to be people of his presence, if we want to be people of Pentecost, if we want to be people that experience revival in these last days, we've got to be people of the altar. I'm reading a book right now that I'll recommend to you, Rebuilding the Altar by Pat Schatzline. Good book. He just released it in August. Powerful evangelist. Rebuilding the Altar. In that book, he mentions a pastor from down south that said there should be four altar call invitations in every call. I never heard that before, but it makes sense. And so today, you're going to get four altar call invitations as you stand all across this room. Please stand. The first call, of course, is one you're familiar with, a call to salvation. If you're here today in this room and you don't know the Lord, or you walked away from God, the good news is Jesus loves you so much that he is your altar. And all you have to do is run to him. Don't worry about having to come in front of people and kneel. Just come to him. Just picture him being right here for you today to receive you into his loving arms, to touch you and forgive you and change you. So if you're here today and you would like to give your life to Jesus Christ, would you right now just lift your hand? Pastor, that's me. I want to give my life to Jesus today. I'm going to give you a moment to come to the altar when everyone else comes, but I'd like to see who you are. I'd like to pray with you this morning. Anybody here like that, you want to give your life to Jesus Christ? God bless you. Anybody else, you want to give your life to Jesus? Ask yourself this question. If you were to die right now, would you go to heaven? Is there anything keeping you from heaven today? You say, Pastor, I've not been living right. Well, friend, just come to Jesus. He loves you. Anybody else here today like to give your life to Jesus Christ? Anyone else? Never want to miss an opportunity. In a moment, we're going to have prayer for this individual along with others. The second altar call invitation the pastor recommended is for people to rededicate their lives to the Lord. So many distractions, so many different things that come our way. And a good thing as the people of God, when we just have allowed our hearts to get a little cold towards God, a little cool towards God, to get our hearts burning for God again by rededicating our lives to Jesus. Maybe that's you today. You need to rededicate your life. You'll have an opportunity in just a moment. The third thing that we definitely need altars for is so that people receive miracles, get healed, get delivered. So thankful. In one altar experience, God saved me and delivered me by his mighty power. And lastly, today, we need to just come as people that maybe don't need to rededicate our lives, but just want to draw closer to the Lord. Just want to experience his nearness. Just to take a word like this and evaluate our own lives. God, what does the altar look like in my life? Thank you as we remember past altars. But today I'm going to rebuild the altar again, and I'm with you, and I know you're going to meet with me, and you're going to just be one that's going to be blessed and touched today. So in just a moment, As soon as I say amen, I want to encourage you to come to the front of this church as quickly as you can, especially each of you that really just feel that God is speaking to your heart right now. Father, thank you for this opportunity to have an altar. God, I thank you that Pentecostal churches have been historically blessed because of altar experiences. God, I thank you for our own altar experiences. I thank you, God, as each of us remember altar experiences with you, how you've touched us and moved on us and changed our lives and provided for us and gave us direction and wisdom. Father, this morning, I ask that you'll move on this one who's giving their life to you. God, as them free, as they commit their life to you, as they repent of their sin and say, Jesus, be my Lord, my God, my Savior, I know today you're going to answer that prayer. Right here in this room, they're going to be changed by your grace and mercy. Father, for those coming forward to rededicate their lives, God, I ask today it will be a powerful moment of rebuilding the altar. And then for those, God, that need healing in their bodies, healing in relationships, healing in their mind, healing in any area of their life, God, I believe that supernaturally at this altar, your Holy Spirit is going to be poured out. Healings are going to take place. Miracles, signs, and wonders are going to be the evidence of a living God that meets with his people. And Father, for all of us that love you and serve you, we have altar times in our life and we're walking after you. We're in the journey of faith. God, for all of us, meet us at this altar today as well. Drop some new wisdom to us, some direction. A new burden. God, whatever you want to do in this altar time, I now release this into your hands. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Begin to come right now.